Welcome to Retouch Pro Live, the only live talk show dedicated to retouching and post-processing. I'm your host, Doug Nelson. Thank you for being part of our live audience today. We'll be discussing Photoshop's Vanishing Point filter with Steve Caplin in just a moment, but first I have some announcements. First of all, let me show you how you'll interact with us today. You should see a panel that says questions. If you don't see this lower section, give this little triangle a click, or it might be a plus sign depending on your operating system. This should drop down. Type your question in here, and don't forget to hit send. Nothing happens if you don't hit send. You can pepper us with comments and questions throughout the program. I will incorporate the ones that I can during the presentation, and we'll circle around and get to the ones that I've missed afterwards, time permitting. Let's see here. I did have a couple of announcements that I wanted to mention. First of all, the uploads. Should you have an image you want to request help with today, send it via our upload site. I just pasted that link in there. Speaking of uploads, remember from the photo illustration show we did, I think it was 3 weeks ago, something like that, that we are inviting the audience to think up an assignment for Steve to do for a future show. So you need to gather together some images, come up with your idea, zip them up, and send them to me. You can do that via the same upload link. If you rewatch the show or if you remember the show, you'll know how this goes. So you can provide the images and the concept. And if it tickles our funny bone, we will build a show around your assignment. Do your best to make sure the images are public domain or at least Creative Commons or something like that. We showed you during that show how to do that. Also, still on the upload situation, Halloween's coming up. We want to do a special Halloween photo montage show. So send us your Halloween-y images or images that you think might make for an interesting Halloween photo montage or might throw an interesting curve there. If you've got a house that you think might look better spooky, or if you've got a particularly photogenic pumpkin, black cats, the sheaves of corn, whatever means Halloween to you, send it again via the upload link. And when we do the show closer to Halloween, we will draw on those images for Steve to make his photo montage. Okay. Want to remind everybody that Retouch Pro Live is brought to you through the generosity of our patrons. Send my thanks to the couple of patrons that signed up in September, but we do need a lot more than that. So I want to encourage you to do that. Go to retouchpro.com/patron. I'll paste that link in right now so you can bookmark it for later. How it works and the advantages you get and everything are all spelled out on the page. You will need to be logged in to see the page, but you'll want to be registered and logged in anyway, so that way you'll always get announcements for future live shows. So retouchpro.com/patron, or just go to retouchpro.com and click on site nav and go down to be a patron. Okay, on with the show. Steve Caplin is a photo illustrator based out of England. I'm thinking close to 30 shows with Steve, all viewable up on YouTube. This show that you're watching right now will also join them shortly. I'll paste in the YouTube link there for you to bookmark for later. While you're there, don't forget to subscribe, please. You can, if you're interested, look at the previous photo montage show to get an idea as to how the way we're going to be working any upcoming photo montage shows. All right, anyway, on with the show. Give me a second here, and I will switch things over to Steve's screen.
And there's my screen. How are
there
you doing?
There we go. Welcome, Steve.
It's good to be back. 30 shows, is it really? We need to have an anniversary when we get to 30.
It's even more than that if you count the rentals, because we've got like 20 of the just of the rentals.
Yeah, of course we count. We count everything. So let me know when we get to 100 and we'll do something special.
We'll throw a party. You'll photo illustrate a party hat or something.
We'll have to, because of course we've never met, because we're the other side of the world from each other. But there we go.
Now, before you get going with Vanishing Point, and I know you've got a lot of things planned, so I don't want to interrupt you then, so I'll interrupt you now. We did a really interesting show about the Photoshop Warp tools last show or show before that or something like that. That again, that's up on YouTube right now if people want to review that. But you showed the perspective warp tool during that show, and it looked dramatic as all heck. And I was just going to ask you quickly if the perspective warp tool has stolen Vanishing Point's thunder.
No, not at all, because they do a very, very different kind of job.
Okay.
The perspective warp tool is all about adjusting the perspective viewpoint of a scene. So, for example, we could take this room and we could move the angle of view so that this corner moves over to here. If we did that, the view through here would go completely haywire.
Mm-hmm.
So there are only certain instances where the perspective warp is going to do a good job. Vanishing Point is about making flat objects fit with the existing perspective of a scene. So it's a very different kind of thing, really.
Okay. Well, that was just bugging me there, and I just wanted to make sure that we weren't talking about a redundant feature.
No, absolutely not. There's tremendous things you can do with Vanishing Point. As we'll see, should we get going with it?
Let's get going. I'm really looking forward to this. I've been looking forward to this for weeks.
So it's great with this kind of scene where you've got squared up rooms. It'd be just as good with the outside of a building as the inside, but you really want to use it where you've got rectilinear objects. It wouldn't be too good in a forest or on the beach, but it's great for things like this.
So square corners, flat planes, things along those lines.
It loves square corners and flat planes, exactly. So let's start by going up to the filter menu. You can always tell how much Adobe like a filter when they put it right at the top here, rather than buried away.
Getting a little crowded up there.
It's near the top. So let's put it here under Vanishing Point. Shortcut, Option Command V or Alt Control V on a PC, and it opens pretty much an identical window.
Okay.
So the first step is to define the 3D plane of your room. And you do that by marking the four corners of a rectangle. Now, let's start with this right-hand wall. We can't do it easily here because we can't see the right-hand edge of the wall. What we can see is the whole of this door surround. And we can assume that that is fully rectilinear.
Okay.
Now, it's quite useful to get accuracy on here. So here's a little shortcut. If you hold the X key down, you zoom in to 100%. Just so you can zoom, keep it so you can zoom in as you're going in to place your points. It just helps to do it. So I'm going to mark the top left corner here. And now you can see the blue line. I'll go over to the top right corner. Very easy now to follow down to where that hits the floor. Mark that point. Now over here we can't quite see that corner, but we can see where the vertical needs to come down in the join of the corner of that wall. We can see where the horizontal follows along the bottom of the architrave there, and we can just click, and there is our first perspective plane. Obviously it's not covering the whole wall, so let's stretch it out so it does. We grab this midpoint handle and we can pull that, and as I drag, you can see it is extending in perspective. We can also drag it up to the ceiling, and once again, there we go, it is fetching in perspective. And it's at this kind of point where you often think, okay, here it's just in the middle of that dark area on the cornice, here it's a bit low, well, we can still correct it. So let's drag that up, and now we've got a truer perspective to match our scene.
Ah, okay. I was going to ask you if it would be better off to get a big, as you say, rectilinear area, or does it matter? Just any straight line?
Anything that you can see, frankly. Yeah, if we had a bigger area, I could have gone for the front of this cupboard here.
Okay.
For example. But the trouble with that, with the wall, is I couldn't see the right-hand edge. So it's worth going for something you can see an entire rectangle.
Okay.
Now, let's do this wall adjacent to it. And to do that, you go over this middle handle again. Rather than just pulling, which will simply make it longer,
mm-hmm.
hold down Command on a Mac, Control on a PC, and when you now pull, you're going to get a 90-degree tear-off.
That has very little to do with the actual wall.
It does, because it's unable to read the perspective of the scene. So you are given two planes in which to define your scene. So to fix this, we can grab this bottom handle and pull that down to the bottom of the wall, and you can see it's gone red. And that red means this is an illegal perspective. This perspective couldn't happen in real life. If we now drag the top handle up to the top, we should find, there we go, that's gone blue again.
Hmm.
That's now happy. So red is absolutely not. If it goes yellow, sometimes it does, I can't make it do that. If it goes yellow, it means you're close, but come on, try again. So there are two. Now, once you've got those two planes, that is defining the whole room. We can tear off another one along the floor. So again, Command or Control, grab that, and we can pull that all the way over to the end here. If we can't quite get it over the edge, well, we can just zoom out using the standard shortcut keys. You can see the huge amount of distortion on here, but you can also see, okay, the rug may not be exactly straight on this floor, mm-hmm. but in general, these lines are matching the perspective of the room that we're dealing with, and that's really what we're after here.
Now, is there also a way, I noticed it's floating above the floor, like, oh, I don't know, a foot or something like that. Is there a way to stomp it down, or does it matter?
No, it is exactly on the floor.
Is it? I was looking at the little line over there on the cabinets.
Yeah, that's because the cabinet is in front of the, it's projecting forward. Look at the back here. That's right along the wall, along the floor.
Ah, okay. So technically the grid is floating under the cabinets, but we're seeing it through the cabinets.
We're seeing it through the cabinets,
okay.
Exactly. So what can we do now we've defined this? Well, the first thing we can do is just to say, okay. And returns us to our image as if nothing has changed. And the reason we want to do that is because when you're working with Photoshop, of course, everything you do is in layers. You don't want to move things around on your background layer because that's, you know, you're going to corrupt it. You're going to end up with something you can't undo later.
Sure.
So let's make a new layer. Yep. We can go back now into Vanishing Point. And when we do so, not only can we see the background, we can see the Vanishing Point there. The Vanishing Point applies to the whole document, not just to one layer.
Ah, okay.
So let's say, okay, first of all, let's take this picture and see how it would look on this wall over here.
Hmm.
We could take it right down to the ground. So let's make a selection of the picture itself. So I'm using just the marquee tool, and we can drag over, and you can see as I'm dragging, I'm simply dragging a rectangle, but it is drawing that rectangle in perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I think that's pretty good in itself, the fact that it's drawing it, you know, in the perspective of the room. Let's switch to the move tool, hold the command key or control on a Mac to get the move tool. We can now hold the option key to move a copy, pick this up, and we can move this around. And you can see as we drag it, it is moving in perspective.
I never get tired of looking at that.
We can drag it around the corner. Whoa. And now it goes in perspective onto this wall. We can scale it. So just as you would in regular Photoshop, Command-T or Control-T, and let's scale that down. So we've got a nice little copy of that just up there. And let's hide the edges, so Command-H or Control-H. Actually, that fits quite well. You can see this wall was a bit more green than this wall, because the wall we've got it onto now is facing the window.
Uh-huh.
To make it blend in, we can turn healing on. And the healing will just blend that into the wall.
Oh,
so
you can do it after the fact.
You can do it afterwards, yeah. So that's quite cool. So you can use this magic wand, this marquee tool. For example, we could do something like, let's say, this probably won't work because it's too complicated. We could say, what would it be like if we took all of these cupboards and moved them further down? Is it going to do that for us? Yeah, so we could slide the whole thing further down the wall. In fact, it's not going to really work. But you get the idea that it is still moving that all in perspective for us in quite a nice way.
Now, I notice up there's something called move modes. What has that got to do with?
I don't know.
Is that like the patch tool where you can either select what the area that you're going to patch from, or you can select the area you're going to patch to?
Well, what we're doing here is, as I'm moving without holding the option key down, it is now dragging where I move over into there. If I change that, I can't change that. I don't know. To be honest, I had never noticed that before, and it's grayed out. Lost it. Sorry. Go back into it.
What, it volunteered to close?
No, I hit the escape key.
Okay.
By accident. One of the things about Vanishing Point is it's not perfect. It's pretty good. It's not perfect, as we'll see. So you really got me there. Move mode. I imagine it's something to do with content-aware moving.
We will put a pin in it, and if we find out definitively what it is, I will put a post in the forum. I'll paste a link right now to the forum thread for today's show so that people can bookmark it and can find out later on this and any other information we talk about during today's show.
So what else we got here? Well, we've got a stamp tool. So let's say we want to make a copy of this bowl of fruit as before. Alt or Option to set the sampling point. And as we go along, you can see a small version of this is the area of the stamp brush, and we can make it larger and smaller using the square bracket keys. And we can paint this in further along here. And you can see it's got this kind of white halo around it. Well, we can easily now turn on healing and try that again.
Now, this time you have to do it beforehand.
There we go. Yeah, while the selection is active, you can turn healing on afterwards. Let's put another one in down here.
What do the green lines mean?
This is a plane that you're currently working on. You can only paint or clone on one plane at a time.
Okay.
So there's our, there's our three bowls of fruit in perspective. Alternatively, let me undo this. We could say we don't want to have that bowl of fruit here. Let's clone from, we'll mark our point just along there. And here we go. We can put in... So as I'm dragging, you can see that's a bit too dark. Mm-hmm. When I let go, there we go. That's the luminance healing coming into play. Now, in fact, the color's slightly different. So we can change that from luminance to on. And what that will do, luminance only affects the brightness of it with it just on. Let's try this again. There we go. It's a slightly better blend.
Now, if you clicked OK right now, don't. But if you did, that healed section would be on the new layer that you created.
Indeed, it would. Let's take a look. I'll click OK.
So if we did need to make further adjustments, we could.
Absolutely right. So there is our there is our layer. So in fact, what's useful about this? Well, let's see what's useful about this now. I'll put that back on. Let's take let's try put another carpet in this room. So here's a much chunkier carpet.
You sure that's carpet?
It's described as rug. Who knows? So I'm going to select all, copy, and hide that. And I'm going to make another new layer, and I'll call it carpet. Back into Vanishing Point. Filter and Vanishing Point. And I'm just going to paste. And there is the rug. And it comes up right at the top. Now, as I drag it, once you get onto a plane, you can see it maps onto that. You can even have it going on two planes going around the corner. Let's take it down onto the floor, and there it is. And that's actually fitting quite nicely onto this floor. So let's put a copy of this in. Hold the Alt or Option key down to make a copy, and now I can drag another one. Let's move this further into the foreground here.
Now, does it have the have the same function as the other as a non-vanishing point selection, so that you can hold hold the shift key and constrain it to be in line?
Yes, indeed you can. Indeed you can. In fact, it is misbehaving slightly for me now. Why is it doing that? It's not moving. Now, for some reason, it's not moving where it should. It's decided to stick itself there. Okay, what I'm going to do is actually say that's where it wants to be. I'll just deselect. And I think I'll use the clone tool. So back to the clone tool. Option or Alt click. And I can sample from right back there. Let's make our brush bigger. And I can paint it all the way up here. And as you can see, once again, it is cloning this rather neatly in perspective. So we've got this very, very chunky bit of rug up here.
Or surface of Mars.
Or surface of Mars. It's whatever you want to call it. It's that kind of a thing. There you go. So, actually, we've got healing on. Let's turn the healing off on this. That might make it a bit happier. Yeah, there we go.
Okay, I wondered what was going on there.
That was the healing. So, now we've got that, we can say okay. And there's our carpet. Of course, it's on a separate layer. That means we can reduce the opacity of this layer. And let's add a layer mask to it. And now we can just use, you know, standard Photoshop techniques to select. I'm just going to do this quite quickly here. To select the cupboard, the chair with its legs, this big chest thing. I think this is a chest in the front of the image here. There we go, back up to that leg, round the bottom. Obviously, if I was doing this for real, I'd take a bit more trouble over.
Sure.
But it's going to give us the idea. Take that and that as well, and fill those with black on the mask. Move the layer back to 100%, and it fits quite nicely in that space.
Okay. And you just the property values are plummeting.
You don't like my copy. Huh? let's try, since it is such a rough carpet, let's make this completely unusable as a cupboard by imagining that the carpet is actually sort of bubbling up over the top of it.
Which it very likely might.
So painting this out on the layer mask makes it a little bit more silly. Now, here's quite an interesting way of dealing with the same thing. Let's take this wallpaper. Once again, I'm going to select all and copy and now hide it. So it's now on the clipboard. I'll make a new layer and I'll call it wall. This time, we'll go back into Vanishing Point. And I'm going to paste again. And there it is. Let's drag it onto this side wall. It's not moving. Come on, don't mess me about. It's not moving.
If you go above the grid so that there's no...
Ah, oh, there we go. That's moving now. I don't know. It's been behaving a little curiously. So there's our wallpaper. And you can see how nicely it's got it into perspective on that wall. I mean, yeah, we could have done this with free transform, but this is quite a good way of doing it. Let's take a copy now around this wall, and you can see it's even coming up on the wall right next to us here.
This is reminding me of that, story, was it Perkins, the yellow wallpaper?
No, I don't know Gilman. This one. I'm going to hit enter, and there it is. Now, all we have to do is change the mode of this from normal to multiply. And, in fact, I have made a selection already. Oh, no, I made a selection, but it doesn't fit because I distorted the room. Okay, well, you can see how easily we could actually go through and take out all the elements we don't want. So we obviously don't want... any of this stuff to show. And so on. So we could work our way around. Because we've got it on a separate layer, because we have set the mode of this layer to multiply, it is picking up the shading that was on this wall. And just making it look, you know, that much more realistic.
Okay.
Really. Now, I know this is, you're talking about property prices. Property that we had before, it's certainly going to drop through the floor with this wallpaper. But, you know, some people like this kind of stuff, so.
I think we need a disco ball or something.
I'm sure that can be arranged. Okay, so there is, that's about as far as you need to go with this. So there's our room. So basically, in a nutshell, this is what Vanishing Point is for. It is for cloning elements and moving elements, for doing composites when you've got a complex design like this in a room or in an outdoor scene where you want to match the existing perspective. And actually, in general, it does it really well.
But it does have to be square, flat, rectangular, things
you
along
have
those
to,
lines.
It only works with flat surfaces. It does not have to be square. You can define angles of greater than or less than 90 degrees. So for example, if you had a book cover that was open but not 90 degrees, then you could specify that.
So when you tear it off, it tears off at 90 degrees, but after you did that, you could go up to the option bar and change that to any arbitrary angle you'd like, or can you just drag it around?
Absolutely. No, you can do just that. So let's go... back into it, back into Vanishing Point, and we'll see exactly how that works. So when you draw your planes, you have the angle slider up here, and you can change that to change the angle. You can also read measurements out of it, and that's quite interesting. So let's say you know that your wall is, I don't know, 3 meters high.
Mm-hmm.
Can you do meters? Are you okay with meters?
I'm okay with meters. They're just yards.
So I drag this down like that until I get 90 degrees. So 0, 90 degrees, actually very close to it, not 0.5 degrees. There we go. And it's saying 2.47. 2.47 what? I have no idea. So let's change that to 3. So we're defining that as being exactly 3 meters.
Mm-hmm.
What we can now do, if we say... link the measurements to the grid, well, two things happen. One is these are now meter squares.
Ah, okay.
Yep, we told it 3 meters. We can say, okay, how, if I wanted to move this picture onto that wall, is there room? How big is this picture? Well, we can measure the base of this picture And there we go. That picture is exactly 1.5 meters across.
That's kind of cool.
So would that fit exactly above these two cupboards? Yes, it would.
We can see that those are 2.5 squares wide, and the pictures are less than 2 squares. So yes, it would.
Exactly. Exactly.
This would be handy for real estate people.
It would indeed. It is not always perfectly accurate, but it's close. I'm not sure how much I would trust this, but then I'm not sure how much I trust people anyway.
When you say not perfectly accurate, do you mean like a couple of percentage points, or do you mean like 50% or whatever?
Well, I'm going to measure the front of this cupboard here, and it's telling me this is 2.5. No, I guess that could be right. If we stood this up on end, would it reach the ceiling? You see, it looks to me like it would reach the ceiling, but maybe it wouldn't.
Maybe it's more accurate than you are.
Maybe it's more accurate than I am. Exactly. That could well be the case. Okay, so I think it is reasonably accurate. I'm not sure I would want to buy a house based on the measurements that I got from Vanishing Point. So there we go. It has many uses for matching perspective. That is the raison d'etre of Vanishing
Point. And there's no reason for us to actually get into it to today's show, but actually you can export all this stuff. If you need it, you already know what it's for. But you can export the grid, you can export the measurements, you can do all that stuff.
Absolutely, you can, and you do all that using this little menu. You can get the grids, and that will simply turn the grids into a Photoshop layer and the measurements. Let's have a look at something a bit more interesting. So I'm going to say okay to that. Let's go on to here we go. We've got a Christmas gift. We want to put this into a scene. It is not quite at the right angle. We can use Vanishing Point to some extent to fix that, and I'm stressing to some extent. So let's go into Filter and Vanishing Point. And once again, we're going to define the plane. It's a little harder to see on here. We start from this corner. Let's go just beyond that corner there, over to this one, and over to that corner. And there is our top. We can hold Command or Control and tear off the side. Actually, this is coming down quite nicely for us. No adjustments needed on there. And we can tear off this other side as well. So there we've got, very, very quickly, the three planes that define this 3D object.
Mm-hmm.
Now, as I say, this is a bit hit and miss, but let's try it. We'll go to this little tiny, I don't know, it's almost like they're embarrassed about this functionality, because they could not have hidden it better if they'd tried. But it's up in this little corner, and we can go to Return 3D Layer to Photoshop. And what happens? Absolutely nothing, because you then have to hit OK. And when you hit OK, it then has a look at what you put up in that little corner, and here it goes. And because Photoshop these days is more about 3D printing than 3D modeling, it's asking how big you want this in millimeters. I don't care. I am not thinking in terms of millimeters. I'll just say, okay. I'll just say, Photoshop, just do what you want. I don't mind. And do you want to switch to 3D workspace? No, not this time. And there it is. Can you see a difference?
It got bigger?
It got marginally bigger. It's actually a new layer. There's our original layer, and here, and here is the new layer. If we switch to the Move tool on this new layer, we find it's a 3D object. And because it's a 3D object, we can turn it around.
Oh, now that's spiffy.
To some degree.
That's
so
kind of scary.
This is not bad. The ribbon on the top. Now, I was going to erase the ribbon, but I thought, actually, I'll leave that there to show you why this isn't quite as good as it looks at first sight. The ribbon, obviously, is flat, so that doesn't move, doesn't change perspective. If you look at how this ribbon goes over the edge here, when you turn it around, that starts to go a little haywire.
But still,
if we look underneath it, you can see it's a stage prop. It's just a hollow object.
Now,
Furthermore,
if you had a non-square object, but still on a white or a transparent background, could you just draw a square around it and it would still?
Yes, indeed. Okay. It would go a bit crazy.
It would go crazy. It would. It
but
would...
For small amounts of movement. So, you know, if you want to move it like from there to there, yeah,
okay,
that's not bad. There's a small amount you could get away with. So, I think that's quite interesting.
It's
that we're able to do this. What we could also do is, now that we've defined the three planes that make up this box, we can put our own textures on. And I'm saying this as if it'll be a complete revelation to you, but since it was you that suggested it in the first place, and in fact gave me these three textures, I'm going to come clean and say, Doug gave me these textures, I think they're really cool. So here's a piece of wood. Select all, copy, hide the wood. Let's make a new layer, and I'll call it Wood Box. Back into Vanishing Point again. Here we go. And
what happened?
Okay, this is what happened. Is I'm going to hide that version of it and go back into Vanishing Point. What happened was it's showing both the original. It was showing both the original grid and the box that I'd rotated.
Ah, okay.
The grid belongs in the document. The grid belongs to the document and not to the layer. But let's paste. So here's our bit of wood. Let's put it in. Yeah, that's quite good there. Let's take a copy of it maybe down onto this side and another copy onto the front. And you can see how it's orienting itself really nicely on each of these sides as we do that. I think it's really good the way it does that.
My favorite part is where it goes to three different planes simultaneously.
It's quite cool, isn't it? So let's say okay to that. Now, what it's not doing is giving us any real shading. So I'm just going to select the top of this and just brighten this up slightly so we get a bit more of a sort of realistic box kind of look. Now, you also gave me this really cool pattern, which I think is such a good idea. See, I wouldn't have thought of this. So I'm going to select all, copy this pattern, and hide it, make a new layer. I'll call it pattern again, back into Vanishing Point. And let's paste. There's our pattern. If we drag it on top of the box, it's too big, so we can use free transform just as we would at any other way in Photoshop. If I can grab one of the corner handles, there we go. So I'm going to drag it right up to that corner and now drag this one down. And you can see it is working just like free transform, but it is working in perspective. And that's one of the things that I think is so cool about Vanishing Point, is that everything now works in perspective. There we go. So there is our inlay for the top of the box. Don't really want it black, so what I'm going to do is actually load this as a selection and now hide it. And now I'm going to make an adjustment layer. And when you have a selection and you make an adjustment layer, that selection becomes the mask for the adjustment layer. So I'm just going to brighten this up and get some nice inlay coming up.
Okay.
There. I think that's quite pretty. And you also suggested this really cool buckle. You see, I wouldn't have thought of this either. This is really your show tonight, Doug. I'm going to select...
Yes, I'm working. I'm sitting here working so hard.
Copy. And I'm going to turn that into a hinge. So let's make a new layer. I have a pair of hinges. Back into Vanishing Point. Here we go. And paste. And let's drag this. I'm going to turn it around and... Oh, as I was dragging this, I was holding the shift key just with regular free transform. That constrains it to 15-degree movements.
Ah, okay.
That's how I'm able to get exactly 90 degrees. And we can now, there we go, do that thing of wrapping this around this corner. I think that's a bit too big, so let's make it smaller. Now, we've got a little bit coming over the edge here. I don't know why it's there. It shouldn't be. I don't care. I'm going to leave that for now. Let's say there's a hinge more or less there. I want another hinge further down. I've got that one in place, so I hold just as you would with any regular Photoshop selection, Alt to make a copy, and as I'm dragging, I hold Shift, and that moves it in. Shift will move things, you know, in a horizontal or vertical direction. Here, it's moving it horizontally, but it's moving it along the front of this box. I'll move it all the way out to there. Good. And I can deselect and just hit OK, and there are hinges. Because it's a separate layer, it's very easy just to grab the eraser, get rid of the bit we don't want. And we're able to build this quite cool, you know, quite ornate box very, very quickly using the textures we want. I mean, okay, we could have done all this. Well, certainly we could have done the wood. We could have done the pattern on the top just using the regular free transform. Making these hinges would have been rather more difficult, I think.
You could even
someone's going to point out they wouldn't work as hinges because they haven't got any hinges in them. But
no, that don't matter. But like, if you had like a coin or whatever, you could bend it around all three corner planes and make those little corner protector things. am I correct?
Don't you? Let's have a look.
Or not necessarily a coin, but just something.
No. If you want a coin, I'll give you a coin. Here we go. Let's have a €1.
There you go.
So copy that.
This is going to make an ugly corner protector.
Let's actually make these hinges a little bit smaller so there's room for the corner protectors.
Is that what they're called? Corner protectors? You know what I'm talking about.
I know what you mean.
You make these boxes in real life.
So there it is on the front. Oh, and to scale it down.
That's what I had in mind.
Yay!
And obviously, you know, in real life, you'd want to have like some ribbons.
Going across both of these corners.
Well, there's not a grid back there.
No, there isn't. But there are two. It's going across.
I guess you could draw grids there if you needed to.
I can put one on. You see, it's going on the side, but not the top. So if I put it on the side, then I can probably put another one on the top. There we go. Just match those up.
Quick and dirty.
And there we go. There it is with our corner protectors. Corner protectors made out of euros, possibly a world first.
And I mean, if you were really going to do this, you'd want to give them some depth or something. I don't even know how you would go about doing that.
Oh, yes, of course. I mean, we do all that kind of stuff. But just to demonstrate, you know, it's not bad. What we'd also, I think, have to do is back on the box layer, we'd have to give it some kind of way of opening. So let's select all of that. And maybe use the burn tool just to is a selection still there? Is still there? Burn, yes, 100%. Interesting.
Fascinating.
Why isn't it doing anything?
Try it without the selection.
Is that the highlights? I could try it on mid-tone. Maybe that's not enough highlights. There we go.
Okay.
So just giving us a bit of a gap where we'd open this up.
And now I'm thinking about, you know, putting a tongue and groove pattern on the side. And
I'm sure you're thinking about all kinds of stuff, but we're going to stop there.
What I'm thinking about is how would we put this box in that living room?
Ah, well, yes, I'm glad you said that. We can't.
Because of the angles?
Well, actually, we've got the box, we've got it here as a 3D object. What we'd have to do... Oh, you are such a pain, Doug. All right, here's what we're going to do. I'm going to take all of these objects that make up the box and merge them into one.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to go back into Vanishing Point. The grid is already there, so I can go to Return 3D Layer to Photoshop. Say OK. That should bring this back as another 3D layer. Then we're going to go to 3D workspace. Good. Layer. I want to duplicate this layer in this image. Let's go back into that one. Bring it up to the top.
That's interesting.
And yeah, actually, you know, it's kind of doing it. Let's bring that down, rotate it a bit, bring it down to the ground. Yeah.
That actually worked better than I thought it was going to.
You know, that's not half bad. And that is how you put a wooden box into a living room.
So we have a hugely outsized a wooden ornate wooden box inside of the world's gaudiest living room.
We do. Where it fits rather perfectly, I think. Cool. Okay, so there we go. That, in a nutshell, is Vanishing Point. It is a very, very powerful tool and unjustifiably overlooked.
I gave you more pictures than just this, and that one of the things, I don't want you to do it, I don't want you to pull it out. Matter of fact, you probably don't have it to pull out or whatever, but I gave you this picture of a long tunnel with curved walls on the side, and I thought it would be interesting to put in some people, but and then give them realistic shadows that were bending up the wall or whatever. And you were saying that Vanishing Point, even though it was a Vanishing Point perspective image, that it would have been a poor choice in that scenario.
A Vanishing Point doesn't like curves. It really doesn't like curves at all. What you could do, you could tear off a series of perspective planes at slightly increasing angles. But I don't think that's going to do anyone any favors.
Really. Well, what I was wondering is could you do it as if there was not a curve and do it just to get the angle and then accept it and then go in and warp it to the curve?
You could, but if you're going to do that, you'd find it much easier just to warp it directly.
There you go. Okay. All right. So have you shown us everything you were going to show us today about Vanishing Point?
I have shown you everything I was going to show you about Vanishing Point.
Okay, I have no questions about Vanishing Point, but you had something else, something unannounced that you wanted to talk about.
I have something else I'd like to show you. It is completely other to Vanishing Point. So what I'm going to do is actually hide everything except our starting image. That looks rather better, doesn't it?
Yes. Back actually, to removing all the damage that we did.
That's not bad. Okay. Right. This is it's an image library called PixelSquid, and it's made by the people who make
TurboSquid,
that's the one. And it's a 3D model image library. And the reason I'm showing it to you is firstly because it's quite cool. Secondly, because they've got a very, very cool Photoshop plugin they just made for it. And thirdly, because for the time being, it's absolutely free.
Oh, that's cool.
So here's how it works. It is 3D objects. So let's search for an object. Doug, you choose a 3D object.
I'm loving that ladybug.
Okay. Let's type that into the search field, and here it is.
Would you call that a ladybird?
I would call that a ladybird.
Okay.
But ladybug is fine. That's all right. It's actually a better name for it because, frankly, it isn't a bird, no matter what you think. So I'm going to open this in a new tab here, and there it is. So it is a 3D render of a ladybird bug.
Mm-hmm.
And you think, what's so cool about this? Well, what is cool? Click and drag to rotate. And we can drag this, and we can rotate it, and we can view it from all these different angles, 225 different angles. And when we find one we like, we can say, yeah, that's pretty good. Let's download that one. It will download it as a PNG file. It should now open it straight into Photoshop.
Well, there's an Add to Photoshop button right there.
There is. I'm going to show you that next. So we can take this. We can click it up here. Let's put it into this file. You want to proceed? Yes. And there it is. And it's not quite, it's not bad, but it's not quite the right angle. So
it's got the drop shadow in there.
It's got the shadow comes with it. Let's try that again. This time, we're going to click this button that says Add to Photoshop.
Okay.
When we go into Photoshop, here is the new, and this came out only last week, the new Turbo Squid panel. Let's just refresh this so it gets the new one. There it goes. I click on that, and it'll now download it again, and here it is. And it appears as a smart object. Yep. So I can take that, I can scale that down. In fact, let's put this just on the side here. And we'll take that around a little bit. That looks pretty good. But I say, I want it facing into the room. Well, here in the Pixel Squid panel, I can drag it around. And let's see.
Oh, now that is cool.
And now, there we go. It's looking that way. And I think, actually, that's looking so good. I'm going to take it back here, and I'm going to make it way bigger again, because I think it looks really quite good there. Because it's a smart object, I can keep doing that. And let's say, maybe have it a little bit more around that way. And I've got, as I say, 225 angles for each of these objects.
So now are these pixels, or is this a 3D object?
These are pixels. These are 3D renders. So what's happening, they have rendered... this would be maybe an hour, 2 hours worth of render if it were a 3D object.
Ah, okay.
So they have rendered this themselves in all these different angles. When you choose it, it's downloading it. And this is a low-res version. Once you get the angle you want, you can then just click the high-res version by pressing this button, and it replaces this smart object with, here we go, there we go, and there's the high-res version.
And so I got to assume sometime in the future, if you click the high-res button, it will replace it and bill your account.
No. No. This is what's clever about it. At the moment, I say everything's free. When they were charging for these objects earlier, and it was about $10, I think, per object.
Mm-hmm.
When you buy it, you buy the object.
Ah,
the, okay. I was talking to the creative head who was saying, well, it's like you buy a prop for a photo shoot. You go and buy your model ladybug. You can view it from many angles. So once you've bought it, you then get all 225 views, and you can do what you like with it, and you can keep on changing your mind, moving it around.
And that little panel there, that's what, like a plug-in or something?
That is a Photoshop plug-in. So let's say we want to add... here we go. Let's put maybe a plant on this this table over here, so we can bring that over. Now we're looking much too far down on that, so let's lift that up slightly and turn it around. There we go. That's quite a good view of that. Let's twist it because our whole room is very slightly leaning over to the side, and let's download the high res of that.
What does the PSD button do?
Well, that is the next thing I'm going to show you.
Okay,
so what I'm going to do is, let's go back to, we'll work with this plant. What's a good thing? No, I'm going to hide this ladybug, and let's go back to, let's get a car in here. So quite a carefully... a chosen selection of objects. The technology is the stuff that works best. So let's take this car, and we'll bring that down, and let's go and turn that around so we've got a more better angle on that. Up a little bit. And so, you know, with your 225 angles, you can get one that's actually really quite good.
Mm-hmm.
So here, I'm going to make it add a PSD. So I'll click the PSD button. So I have to save this first. So let's just save this file. There we go. Replace with layers. So when I do this, it's going to replace this with a Photoshop document. It will no longer be linked to the original, so I can't change the angle of view anymore. But what I can do is something really quite clever. So here it comes. And it's going to take a little while to come in, but there we go. And it's now building all of that. And here it is. So in this group now is
they're all turned off.
PS sizing layer. Okay. For some reason, it shrunk it down. Oh, I think because I didn't download the high res first, but that's okay. It's a smart object, so the whole thing is in there. So, what have we got here? As well as this, we've also got. Let's start with this one: selection areas. So, selection by part.
Oh, okay.
So every part of the car is a different color, and that is great. It means you can use the magic wand to go onto this. So, if you want to change the windscreen there, I can easily select that as one object because it's the magic wand that lets me do it. I can now hide that, and there is the windscreen.
Okay.
And I can maybe make that a little bit more blue.
Mm-hmm.
So it can go on to our, whatever. We could add an adjustment layer to do that. We could also have select by material. So I could select here to select all the metalwork of this car.
Hmm.
Yep, and you can see it's got all of that now selected. Let's do that. Yep. All the metalwork is selected. Now I can hide that, go back into the car, and I can add a curves adjustment layer. So we could say, let's take some of the red out of this.
Hmm. Okay.
Yep. So really a very, very useful thing. We've also got this depth map. And let's have a look at this on pass-through. Let's have a look at this at by itself. There we go. And you can see what's happening in this depth map is it's very white at the back going to much more transparent at the front there.
Mm-hmm.
This is giving you a 3D depth map of this car. So if you load this up as a selection, okay, I'm going to copy this. I'm going to go into Quick Mask and now paste. So here is that depth map, which I'm lining up with the car here. And if I go out of Quick Mask, I'm hoping this is going to work. If I now add a blur onto this, filter blur and Gaussian blur. Is this doing it for me? It is not, because for some reason the depth map is... okay, right. So as you can see, the depth map is not doing what it should be doing
in
this case.
I did see something happening on that layer mask whenever you've adjusted the I think it's just that it's too transparent.
It's too transparent. Okay, I will check this one out. But what it does is it gives you the back of the car is going to be less selected than the front, so that you can then have like a kind of focus blur. You could have a depth
sure.
of field effect that you can build into this. So, and of course, you can also say, well, I don't like the shadows. Well, you can just turn the shadows off. Or you can say, I really like the shadows, but I want them stronger. Well, then you can just duplicate that shadow layer to get the stronger shadows. So not only does it give you, this car from all these different views, once you've got the view you want, you can then very easily select any part of it. And you can see here we've got shine, reflection, lighting, all on separate layers. Here we go. So now we can take the shine up and down. We can change the amount of reflection on this car and so on.
That is pretty cool.
So we can do an awful lot with it, all based on the fact that we can manipulate these images as we like. So it's called PixelSquid. There are about 3,500 objects at the moment. They are adding, they reckon, about 50 objects a day. Very good for things like if I do a search for money. So very often you'll see images of, like banknotes. They've got Euro banknotes. They've got British banknotes as well. But also things like, open money bags, great for doing montages.
Huh.
And so often you'll see things like, you see a picture of a stack of dollars, but you think it's not quite the angle that I want. Well, now you can make it, you know, just the angle that you want.
And this is all free.
For the time being, this is free. For maybe the next week or two, this is free.
Okay.
But what you can do is you can have up to 100 objects in your lightbox. If you get them when you're free, when they're free, then I think you just keep them.
And do you have any idea what this is going to be when there are not free?
They haven't said yet. I'm guessing around about $10 per object.
And will you be able to, like, audition low-res versions like you can with, or watermarked versions like with stock art?
No.
But I mean, audition.
Interesting. That I don't know.
Okay.
I don't believe so. But, I mean, you know, with any of these objects, look at these. These are really cool. I like these falling cascade. There are so many times in the past I could really have done with a thing like this. Not just a cascade of coins, but a cascade of coins that I can view from any angle.
But as far as you know, if we add it to our lightbox now, even whenever they discontinue this free program, you will still be able to keep the 100 items in your lightbox.
That's correct.
Okay. That's a good tip.
That is what I understand from my conversation with them last week. So, the things that work well are technology. They're very fond of Macs. So they've done every model of Apple from pretty much the earliest days here, an early Mac Plus.
But let's give this a test. I don't care about all this shiny stuff. Show me a cat.
Ah, okay. They don't do them.
Not at all.
Because they've only done stuff that can be effectively modeled. So if I do a search for cat, that's the closest you're going to get.
Ah, okay. Okay.
Yep. So they've really thought quite hard about the objects that they're showing here. Here are the categories, things like people. No, they don't do people. Characters, they do these very much cartoon people.
Okay.
Models of people, but things like, you know, this this handbag, that's pretty good. This pair of shoes work very well. They have recognized the limitations of the technology they're using, and they really haven't tried to push it beyond that. Because the last thing they want is people saying, you know, I downloaded a cat, it doesn't look anything like a cat. But if you want a cartoon sheep, then that's great.
Sean, yeah.
Yeah. So there we go. Nothing to do with Vanishing Point.
That's
but
fine.
Because
that's fine.
It's on a limited time, I thought you really ought to know about
What I really feel sorry for are the YouTube viewers from a month from now. This free offer will be completely gone by then.
Yeah, but the website will still be there. They'll still be able to take a look at it. I'm sure they will make a selection of images available for free so you can download and try out the technology.
Oh, I know what we need to look for. Triceratops.
Okay, let's have a look for a dinosaur.
No, Triceratops, because that's what we used in one of your previous shows.
Well, I've got a Triceratops skull.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, I've got this other kind of dinosaur. I don't know what this is.
Dick something. It looks like a raptor to me, so.
Yeah, it's a kind of raptory type thing. But as I say, so there are 3,500 objects here at the moment, and they are adding 50 or so a day.
What is editorial, and why are we including it?
I don't know. I've wondered about that checkbox.
Is that just the name?
I think I don't know, if I uncheck that, what happens? Yeah, I don't know. I think advertising and editorial, I don't know. I'll have to find out what that does. That does
not a clue.
Bafflingly.
Not a clue. We need to get PixelSquid as a sponsor for RetouchPRO Live so that we can offer coupons and stuff.
They certainly should be. But you know, for all these kind of things, they're really a great selection of objects. You know, you're doing a montage. Do you want to have a briefcase in there, or a chair that's fallen over, or you know, any kind of office equipment. If it's hard and shiny, then it's going to work out really well.
For somebody like you that needs kind of this stuff like this professionally, do they have like an all-you-can-eat plan?
Again, they haven't announced that yet.
Okay.
I don't know. I imagine they will. I'd be very surprised if they didn't do that. But at the moment, they're just trying to really push the idea of it.
Heck, they should just hire you to make things with this to show how wonderful it is and give them to you in return.
Well, at the moment, I'm busy downloading stuff. What they've done with their Photoshop plugin is absolutely unique. You know, they have created a way of interacting with smart objects, in particular the way that they interacted with embedded objects that I've never seen done before. So even though that was a while ago, let's hide this car, let's bring back this lady insect thing, and we can still go back to this, even though we've downloaded the high res, we can still say, no, that's actually, let's say this is CD's best days. Can we have it flat on its back?
Ah, it's attacking.
Yeah, not bad. All I need to do is turn this upside down. There we go.
Dead bug.
A dead bug, exactly. And again, it has downloaded the high res because that's what my settings are on. It's cool. You're talking about the fact that there's a shadow. Well, there is a shadow. When it's looking at it from below, there's no shadow. So they've really thought about this. All of these Photoshop layers have all been automatically generated from the 3D models, but an awful lot of thought has gone into this, and I absolutely love the way that this plugin works.
Marvelous.
Particularly good, in fact, for transparent objects. So if I let me just hide that for a moment. If I put in something like here we go, this jar. There we go, and you can see, you know, the way that you've got the opaque portions of it, you've got the transparent portions of it. It's really nice. All you have to do is to distort the view that you see through it.
Sure.
And you'd have, frankly, a really good jar model in this.
That is very, very cool. And you say this is just pixelsquid.com, all one word.
Pixelsquid.com, exactly. Yeah.
Marvelous, marvelous.
I have a play with it. I wasted a whole two or three evenings last week just playing and playing with this because it was so much fun. Just to say, you know, I'm going to build this. I'm going to take this object. What can I put inside it? Well, I can maybe put this ladybug inside there. Oh, that's a bit too big now, isn't it? So let's scale that down.
And I'm assuming there's like a link on their front page for you to download the plugin.
Yep, absolutely. In fact, you have to go via the Adobe website to download the plugin, but you can still do that.
I'm assuming there are like at least instructions there on how to do it.
Oh yeah, they make it absolutely very straightforward for you.
Because that panel is one of the cooler things I've seen.
I have never seen a Photoshop panel that can do anything like this. So, you know, in a case like this, I want to put this inside here. Well, obviously, I'll just load that as a selection, go onto our glass jar, add a layer mask, and just mask out, you know, where that comes in front of it, and so on. But it's good stuff, isn't it?
Marvelous, marvelous.
Hmm.
Okay.
Have a play. Go and have a play. You'll hate me in the morning because you'll spend all night playing.
I'm eager to get over there. Do you have anything else to show us today?
No, I'm going to stop there. Oh, one thing about the plugin, it requires Photoshop CC 2014 or 2015.
Okay, well, that's pretty much a given.
If you have an earlier one, you can still download the PNG files. You can still download the PSDs, but for all your positioning, you have to do it.
Right. All the fun stuff requires the current version.
All the really fun stuff. They're still fun stuff, but it's the ability to do it straight in Photoshop that I think is just astonishing.
Marvelous.
There we go.
Marvelous. Are we going to do the Halloween show this year?
Absolutely. Let's do a Halloween show. We can't let a year go by without doing a Halloween show.
Does PixelSquid have some Halloween-y stuff?
I did ask them about that. I said, you should do some skeletons. And they said, yeah, we're working on Halloween.
I was going to ask you if we could do some something with, like, poser skeletons or something. Is that something that would be...
Yeah, I've always used poser skeletons in my Halloween shows. We could certainly do that.
I just didn't know if there was enough time, and considering, you know, just an hour to pose and render a skeleton in a poser and bring it over.
Yeah, absolutely. Of course we can.
Well, I want to invite the audience to send us your Halloweenish images. If you've got something that you think would make a good contribution to a Halloween photo montage, like I say, if you've got a spooky looking house or a house, a normal looking house that should be made to look spooky, or something along those lines, send it to retouchpro.com/upload, and I will stockpile them, and then during the Halloween show I will launch them upon Steve. There you go.
There you go. Yeah, so I'm sure they'll be adding, you know, plenty more stuff.
Marvelous, marvelous. And if you want to challenge Steve to any sort of general photo illustrative assignment, as I said before, use the same upload link. Come up with a theme. Come up with a find the images, zip them up, and send them over. And if it tickles our funny bone, or if we think it'll illustrate some good techniques, we will feature your work in a show all by itself. Marvelous.
Great.
I want to remind everybody, become a patron. If you like today's show, if you want to see more shows like today, if you would like to be, if you'd like to help me afford Pixel Squid, need patrons. So retouchpro.com/patrons. Want to try to see if we can beat September's level of 2. We really need, you know, 20 times that amount just to pay for the software. And let's see, I want to remind everybody that there is a forum thread for today's show, so whenever we find out what that one command does, we will post it there. And if there's anything else we think about, I might throw some Pixel Squid up stuff up there. And if you've got some fun things that you've done with Vanishing Point, feel free to post them there. We want to see your work. I think that is everything. Do you have any final thoughts today, Steve?
No, I had one final thought. The images that you showed me came from a royalty-free website that I actually hadn't heard of before, which was called, what was it called? Pix something.
Pixel Junk?
What was that site you used?
I used Google. It was a Pixel Stuff or Pixel Junk or...
It was called Pix something, and it was really good, and I've forgotten the name of it. Pix Bay?
No. Actually, I think it was Pixel Bay.
Pixabay, there we go. I hadn't come across this one before, so I'm just introducing it to you. It is 470,000 free photographs.
Yeah, we're not affiliated with them or anything. I was just using Google's image search under Creative Commons licensed for alteration, and they came up. And of course, you see they also have like Shutterstock stuff mixed in there.
Well, the top row is ads for Shutterstock.
Okay.
But frankly, you can forgive them that because they have a very, very good selection of royalty-free images. Royalty-free images that don't even need accreditation. So it's really good. I like this very much, and have a play with this. I'd not come across this before. You sent me a link to an image that was on here, but Pixabay everyone's giving everything away. You know, Pixabay giving away their images. PixelSquid are giving away their 3D models. We're giving away our
the
webinars.
Show.
How
yes.
does anyone make any money these days?
I'm not.
No, exactly. That's lucky you and I can live on air, isn't it?
Maybe you can, Steve. Maybe you can. I don't have the inheritance and the castle in Derbyshire or wherever you're. Marvelous, marvelous. Well, thanks a bunch. This has been really, really fun. That was the most god-awful, ugly living room I've ever seen, and I'm an appreciator of things like that. And you threw in some good little bonus tips there in the end, so we appreciate that. All right. Well, I want to say thank you to the audience for showing up today. Thanks to Steve, and I will see everyone in the forums. Bye-bye, everyone. Bye-bye, Steve.
Bye.